ये स्टार्टिंग इवेंट हो रहा है।
हाँ मैडम,
गुड मॉर्निंग, आई वेलकम
मैडम
ऑल द व्यूअर्स टू दिस वेबिनार कंडक्टेड बाय
स्क्रीन
डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एनाटॉमी
शेयर कर दीजिए
गवर्नमेंट।
मैडम। एक सेकेंड, आप स्क्रीन शेयर जहाँ पे लिखा आ रहा है वहां हाँ
पर जस्ट प्रीव्यू बटन करिए, प्रीव्यू
स्टॉप शेयर
प्रीव्यू करिए,
करिए।
जहाँ राइट साइड में प्रीव्यू लिखा आ रहा है उसको क्लिक करिए। करिए राइट साइड में, मैं आपकी स्क्रीन देख पा रही हूँ, आप प्रीव्यू पे क्लिक करिए। जस्ट क्लिक ऑन द प्रीव्यू मैम, प्लीज जल्दी
कर
कर
दिया
लीजिए
कर
थोड़ा
दिया
सा।
कर दिया। स्टार्ट कर दें मैडम। आप
हाँ स्टार्ट
प्रीव्यू
करिए
को
मैडम,
मैडम
स्टार्ट
स्टार्ट
करिए
करिए।
और उसको स्टार्ट करके छोड़ दीजिए प्लीज एक बार।
ठीक
ठीक है, मेरे को प्रेजेंटेशन भेजने की जरूरत ही नहीं है,
ठीक
यही से स्टार्ट होगी। दिख रहा है आपका प्रेजेंटेशन स्क्रीन पे?
हाँ हाँ दिख रहा है।
ठीक है, अब अपना स्क्रीन शेयर ऑफ कर, एक सेकेंड, अपना स्क्रीन शेयर ऑफ कर दीजिए।
ऑफ ही है मैडम।
प्रेजेंटेशन दिख रहा है अभी आपका स्क्रीन पे? ठीक
मैडम थोड़ा ब्लू दिख रहा है। ठीक है स्क्रीन पे
क्लियर दिख रहा है मैडम,
क्लियर दिख रहा है। ठीक है ठीक है।
क्लियर दिख रहा है, क्लियर दिख रहा है।
अंजू मैम यू कैन बिगिन।
ओके, वेलकम ऑल द व्यूअर्स, आई वेलकम ऑल द व्यूअर्स ऑफ दिस वेबिनार ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एनाटॉमी गवर्नमेंट होम्योपैथिक मेडिकल कॉलेज भोपाल मध्य प्रदेश। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम आर गेस्ट स्पीकर डॉक्टर वंदना शर्मा मैम। आई वेलकम विथ डीप रिगार्ड्स डॉक्टर एम के अग्रवाल, IAS, सेक्रेटरी एंड कमिश्नर ऑफ आयुष डिपार्टमेंट गवर्नमेंट ऑफ मध्य प्रदेश। आई ऑल्सो एक्सटेंड माई रिगार्ड्स टू आर प्रिंसिपल सर डॉक्टर एस के मिश्रा। आई ऑल्सो वेलकम माई हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एनाटॉमी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ गवर्नमेंट होम्योपैथिक मेडिकल कॉलेज डॉक्टर मुकेश कविश्वर सर। आई ऑल्सो एक्सटेंड माई वेलकम टू ऑल माई सीनियर कलीग्स एंड माई जूनियर कलीग्स इन माई कॉलेज एंड इन ऑल अदर मेडिकल कॉलेजेस इन भोपाल मध्य प्रदेश इंडिया एंड ऑफ कोर्स आउटसाइड इंडिया टू। आई एक्सटेंड माई वेलकम टू ऑल द डॉक्टर्स हु आर व्यूइंग दिस प्रोग्राम टूडे एंड लास्ट बट नॉट द लीस्ट आई वेलकम ऑल माई डियर स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ गवर्नमेंट होम्योपैथिक मेडिकल कॉलेज एंड ऑल द अदर होम्योपैथिक मेडिकल कॉलेज स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ भोपाल मध्य प्रदेश इंडिया एंड ऑल अराउंड द वर्ल्ड। अलॉन्ग विथ द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ होम्योपैथिक मेडिकल कॉलेज आई ऑल्सो एक्सटेंड माई वॉर्म वेलकम टू ऑल द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ ऑल द आयुष डिपार्टमेंट कॉलेजेस लाइक यूनानी कॉलेज, आयुर्वेदिक कॉलेज, स्पेशली द टू कॉलेजेस विच आर आर नेबर्स, पंडित खुशीलाल शर्मा कॉलेज एंड यूनानी कॉलेज इन कालियासोत डैम परिसर। द स्टूडेंट्स आर द मोस्ट वेलकम्ड पीपल ऑफ दिस वेबिनार बिकॉज दिस इज मेंट फॉर देम। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई विल लाइक टू इंट्रोड्यूस माई स्पीकर द रिसोर्स पर्सन डॉक्टर वंदना शर्मा। शी नीड्स नो इंट्रोडक्शन बेसिकली, बट स्टिल सिंस इट इज अ प्रिवलेज टू इंट्रोड्यूस हर आई वुड लाइक टू टेक द प्रिवलेज। डॉक्टर वंदना शर्मा, शी इज MBBS एंड MS एनाटॉमी। शी इज HOD ऑफ एनाटॉमी डिपार्टमेंट इन गांधी मेडिकल कॉलेज भोपाल मध्य प्रदेश. Mukesh Kavishwar sir, he is also MBBS and MS, and he is head of the department of anatomy department in Government Homeopathic Medical College. After the introduction of our speakers and my HOD, I would like to say a few words on the topic. Today's topic that we are going to take is about thyroid gland. Thyroid gland is a very important, it's an endocrinal gland, you all must be knowing. And even the laymen today are concerned about the thyroid gland because we have heard so much about hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism. So everybody must be anxious to know about the anatomy of this gland. One question is usually asked, why anatomy in homeopathy? See, whatever the pathy is, anatomy of our body is very important. We should know the structure of each and every organ and step of our body so that we know what that organ is about, how it functions, what are its relations, what is its blood supply, nerve supply, etc. So without knowing what are the actual organs that we are made up of, how are we going to find a disease related to it? So that is why all the structures should be known to us. Their functions must be known to us. After saying this, I will not take any more time and would like our resource person, Dr. Vandana Sharma, to take over, and I will expect all the students to gain immensely from her lecture. Madam, you may take over. Thank you.
Ma'am, please on your audio, Dr. Vandana, from your, on your screen.
Vandana,
yes, ma'am. Thank you so much.
I'll start your lecture.
Good morning to all. I am Dr. Vandana Sharma. Can you hear me, madam?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Okay. So good morning to all. I am Dr. Vandana Sharma, professor and head, Department of Anatomy, Gandhi Medical College, Bhopal. And today's topic of discussion is anatomy of thyroid gland. As we know, the thyroid gland is the largest endocrine gland of our body. And it is situated in front of the neck. And it weighs approximately 25 grams. So it is the very important endocrine gland of our body. And it is very important for the normal functioning of our body. And it is situated superficially in the body in front of the neck, and it can easily palpable. And it depends on the for hormone synthesis, depends on the iodine. And it does not secrete its hormone directly into blood, and it stores the hormone inside the follicles of gland, and it releases when we require. Then about the location of the thyroid gland. It lies against the 5th, 6th and 7th cervical vertebra and 1st thoracic vertebra in front of the C5, C6, C7 and T1 vertebra. It is H-shaped, two lobes and in between stemmas. So it is H-shaped and it has two lobes, right and left lateral lobes, and horizontal part is isthmus. So this is isthmus, and these are the right and left lateral lobes. And it is situated against the C5, C6, C7 and T1 vertebra. Then from the isthmus or horizontal part, a small pyramidal lobe projects upward from the isthmus and left to the midline, and it is connected to the body of hyoid bone by a fibromuscular band, which is known as levator glandular thyroidy. So it has a small pyramidal lobe which is connected with the hyoid bone via levator glandular thyroidy. And each lateral lobe extends upward to the oblique line of thyroid cartilage and below up to the fifth or sixth tracheal rings. So upper margin of lateral lobe extends up to the oblique line of thyroid cartilage and below up to the fifth or sixth tracheal ring. And isthmus extend across the midline in front of the second, third and fourth tracheal rings. And its weight's approximately 25 grams, and the dimensions of lateral lobe is height approximate 5 cm, width 3 cm and thickness is approximate 2 cm, and the dimensions of isthmus is approximately 1.25 cm length and 1.25 cm width. Then we talk about the capsule of the thyroid gland. As we know, it has two capsules, true capsules and false capsules. And true capsule is formed by the condensation of the fibrous stroma of the gland. And false capsule is derived from the splitting of pre-tracheal fascia. And the features of this false capsule is traced above the pre-tracheal fascia after enclosing the thyroid gland, is attached to the oblique line of thyroid cartilage and to the body of the hyoid bone. And on the medial surface of thyroid lobe, it thickens to form the suspensory ligament of Berry, which connects the lobe to the cricoid cartilage. So lobes connected with the cricoid cartilage via suspensory ligament of Berry. So this is about the true capsule and false capsule, derived from the fibrous stroma and false capsule from the pretracheal fascia. And these all fascia is the derivative of the deep cervical fascia of neck. Then importance of these capsules is between true capsule and false capsule. The dense venous plexus, which lies deep to the true capsule of thyroid gland. Therefore, during thyroidectomy, the thyroid gland is removed along with the true capsule to avoid hemorrhage. In case of prostate gland, these venous plexus lies between the two capsules, and here this venous plexus lies deep to the true capsule, and in prostate gland this venous plexus lies between the true and false capsule. Therefore, during prostatectomy, prostate gland is removed, leaving behind both the capsules to avoid the hemorrhage. Then we talk about the relations of thyroid gland and thyroid lobes. Each lobe is roughly pyramidal in shape and have apex, base, and three surfaces: lateral surface, medial surface, and posterior lateral surface. And has two borders: anterior border and posterior border. And the apex is directed upwards and slightly laterally, and it extends up to the oblique line of thyroid cartilage, where it is limited above by the attachment of sternothyroid muscle. As we know, the oblique line of thyroid cartilage, three strap muscles are also attached, and it is limited above by the apex is limited above by the attachment of sternothyroid muscle. So this is the picture. It shows here oblique line of thyroid cartilage and three strap muscles, thyrohyoid, sternothyroid, and deep to this is inferior constrictor. So these three muscles attached on the oblique line of thyroid cartilage, and this dotted line shows the apex of the lateral lobe of thyroid gland. Then this apex is sandwiched between the inferior constrictor muscle medially and sternothyroid laterally. So this picture shows this is the apex of thyroid gland, this is inferior constrictor, this is sagittal section, and this is thyrohyoid muscle, and above the apex seen the superior thyroid artery and external laryngeal nerve, and this is sternothyroid muscle. So it's sandwiched between the sternothyroid muscle and inferior constrictor muscle. This is thyroid cartilage, then cricoid cartilage, and below this tracheal rings are seen. This is again here we can see inferior constrictor muscle, and this is cricothyroid muscle. This is the lateral lobe of thyroid gland. And superior, at the apex, above the apex, we can see the superior thyroid artery and external laryngeal nerve. And this is common carotid artery, which divides into the external carotid and internal carotid. And the base extend up to the fifth or sixth tracheal ring. So this is the base which extend up to the fifth or sixth tracheal ring. These are the tracheal rings. And it is related to inferior thyroid artery and recurrent laryngeal nerve. Here we can see this is inferior thyroid artery and this is recurrent laryngeal nerve. Then about the lateral surface, also known as superficial surface. It is convex and is covered by three strap muscles: sternothyroid, sternohyoid, and superior belly of omohyoid. So three strap muscles covers the superficial or lateral surface. Then inferiorly overlapped by anterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle. Inferiorly, it is overlapped by the anterior border. This is sternocleidomastoid muscle, and this is anterior border of sternocleidomastoid. So inferiorly, it is overlapped by the anterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle, and here three strap muscles covered the superior surface of lateral surface. These are the sternothyroid, sternohyoid, and superior belly of omohyoid. Also, in this picture, we can see these are the three strap muscles, and also this is sternocleidomastoid. Then about the medial surface. Medial surface related with the trachea and esophagus. And two muscles, inferior constrictor and cricothyroid. And two cartilages, cricoid and thyroid cartilage. So two tubes, trachea and esophagus, related with the medial surface, two muscles, inferior constrictor and cricothyroid muscle, and two cartilages, cricoid cartilage and thyroid cartilage. These are the two tubes, two cartilages, and these are the two muscles. Then about the posterolateral surface. It is related to carotid sheath and its content. So posterolateral surface related with the carotid sheath, which contain common carotid artery, internal jugular vein and vagus nerve. This is carotid sheath, related with the posterior lateral surface and has internal jugular vein, vagus nerve and common carotid artery. And the ansa cervicalis is embedded in the anterior wall of sheath, while cervical sympathetic chain lies posterior to sheath. So ansa cervicalis is situated here anteriorly and this cervical sympathetic chain is lies posterior to the sheath. Then about the borders of thyroid gland. Anterior border and posterior border. Anterior border separates superficial and medial surface and it is related to anterior branch of the superior thyroid artery. And posterior border separates the medial and posterior surface. It is related to the arterial anastomosis between superior and inferior thyroid arteries and parathyroid gland. Diagram, we can see this is superior thyroid artery and this is inferior thyroid artery. Superior thyroid artery is branch of this external carotid artery. And this is anterior border which separates the lateral surface from the medial surface. And posterior border which separates the medial surface from the posterior lateral surface. And posterior border is related with the arterial anastomosis between superior and inferior thyroid artery. Then about the relations of isthmus or the horizontal part of the thyroid gland. It has two surfaces, anterior and posterior, and two borders, superior and inferior. So anterior surface is related with the strap muscles, sternohyoid and sternothyroid, and anterior jugular vein. And posterior surface related to the second, third, and fourth tracheal veins. So anterior surface related with the strap muscles and jugular vein, and posterior surface related with the tracheal veins. Then superior border of isthmus related to anastomosis between the anterior branches of two superior thyroid artery. So superior border related to anastomosis between the anterior branches of two superior thyroid artery. Here we can see the anastomosis between the branches of anterior branches of two superior thyroid arteries. And in this is inferior border. And here inferior thyroid vein emerges from here and thyroidema artery. When present, it this artery occasionally present. If it is present, it enters through this part, through inferior border of isthmus. Then about the blood supply of thyroid gland. It is highly vascular gland, and two arteries, superior thyroid artery, which is branch of external carotid artery, supplies the upper one third of the lobe and upper half of the isthmus. It runs downwards and forwards in company with the external laryngeal nerve. So superior thyroid artery accompany with the external laryngeal nerve. At apex of lateral lobe, it divides into anterior and posterior branches. Then anterior branch first descends along the anterior border of the lobe and then continues along the upper border of isthmus to anastomos with the fellow of opposite side or the anterior branch of opposite side superior thyroid artery. Then the posterior branch descends along the posterior border of lobe to anastomos with the ascending branch of inferior thyroid artery. And inferior thyroid artery, it is a branch of thyrocervical trunk which arises from the first part of the subclavian artery. So this is a subclavian artery, and first part of subclavian artery, this is thyrocervical trunk, and this is inferior thyroid artery which arises from here and supplies the thyroid gland, and it accompanies the recurrent laryngeal. And here superior thyroid artery divides at the apex onto anterior and posterior branch. Posterior branch descends along the posterior border, anterior branch along the anterior border, and it accompanies the external laryngeal nerve. And inferior thyroid artery supplies lower two-thirds of the lobe and lower half of the isthmus. Then the artery gives four or five branches, one ascending branch, anastomosed with the posterior branch of the superior thyroid artery. And sometimes thyroidema artery is also present, a branch of the brachiocephalic trunk, or may arise directly from the arch of aorta. So thyroidema artery occasionally present and arise from the may arise from the brachiocephalic trunk or arch of aorta, and it enters the isthmus from below. And accessory thyroid arteries arise from the tracheal and esophageal arteries. This is about the blood supply of the arterial supply of the thyroid gland. Then about the venous drainage. Superior thyroid vein, it emerges at the upper pole of the thyroid lobe. You can see in diagram that the superior thyroid vein emerges from the upper pole of thyroid lobe, runs upward and laterally and drain into the internal jugular vein. Then middle thyroid vein, short wide venous channel, emerges at the middle of the lobe, enters into the internal jugular vein. Then about the inferior thyroid vein, emerges at the lower border of the isthmus and forms plexus in front of the trachea, runs downward to drain into the left brachiocephalic. And fourth one is thyroid vein of Kocher, rarely present and emerges between the middle and inferior thyroid vein and drain into the internal jugular vein. So this is the picture of the vein, superior thyroid, middle thyroid and inferior thyroid vein and Boucher's vein. Then about the lymphatic drainage of thyroid gland. Lymph vessels draining the thyroid gland are arranged into two groups, upper and lower groups. Upper group follows superior thyroid artery, which drains into prelaryngeal lymph node, and upper deep cervical jugulodigastric lymph node. So, upper group into the prelaryngeal lymph node or for deep cervical lymph nodes. Then lower group follow the inferior thyroid arteries and drains into pretracheal lymph nodes, lower deep cervical lymph node, and group of lymph node along the recurrent laryngeal nerve. This is the recurrent laryngeal nerve, and these are the lymph nodes along the recurrent laryngeal. These are the pretracheal lymph node and lower deep cervical lymph node. Then lymphatics from lower part of isthmus drain into retroesternal or brachiocephalic node. These are the retroesternal or brachiocephalic node, lying in the superior mediastinum. Then about the nerve supply of the thyroid gland. Its parasympathetic supply derived from the vagus and recurrent laryngeal nerve. And its sympathetic supply derived from the superior, middle, and inferior cervical sympathetic ganglia. So parasympathetic from vagus and recurrent, and sympathetic from the superior, middle and inferior cervical sympathetic ganglia, mainly from the middle cervical sympathetic ganglia. Then we talk about the microscopic structure of thyroid gland. In most of the endocrine glands, cells are arranged in cords or clumps, and their secretory products are stored within their cytoplasm. Like the thyroid gland, it is a unique endocrine organ in which cells are arranged into spherical structures called follicles. Follicles are the structural and functional unit of thyroid gland. And each follicle is surrounded by reticular fibers and vascular network of capillaries that allows for easy entrance of thyroid hormone into the bloodstream. So surrounding reticular fibers and vascular network helps in the entrance of thyroid hormone into the bloodstream. The follicular epithelium can be simple squamous or cuboidal or simple columnar. It depends on the state of activity of the thyroid gland. This is the picture of microscopic anatomy of thyroid gland. We can see here follicles, and these are the follicular cells and epithelium in active stage, simple cuboidal, and in follicle, inside the follicle you can see colloid. This is the colloid, and the cells that surrounds the follicle synthesize, release and store their products outside of their cytoplasm or extracellularly in the lumen of the follicles as a a gelatinous substance which is known as colloid. And colloid is composed of thyroglobulin, an iodinated glycoprotein that is the inactive storage form of the thyroid hormone. So it is inactive storage form of thyroid hormone. Then the thyroid gland consists two types of secretory cells. One is follicular cells, also known as principal cells. Another one is parafollicular cells. So follicular cells secrete two hormones, thyroxin and triiodothyronine. These hormones are essential for normal growth and development, especially of the skeletal and nervous system. And parafollicular cell is larger and pale staining cells and found mainly between the basement membrane and the follicular cells. Some of them also lie in the space between the follicles. And they secrete a hormone, calcitonin. It reduces the blood calcium level by reducing the reabsorption of the calcium by the renal tubule. Calcitonin secreted by the parafollicular cell, and its function is reduces the blood calcium level. So these are the follicular cells, and in between follicular cells or in between the follicles, parafollicular cells also present, which is large pale staining cells. So two types cells present, follicular and parafollicular cells. This is a picture of microscopic anatomy of thyroid gland. These are the follicles, follicular cells, and here you can see the parafollicular cells in between the follicles. These are the connective tissue septa, then venules, and follicle with ducted colloid, capillaries, and arterioles also present in between the follicles. These are the connective tissue septa. And here also parafollicular cells. So this is the picture of histological picture or microscopic anatomy of thyroid gland. Then we talk about the development of thyroid gland. How thyroid gland develops. The thyroid gland begins to develop as endodermal thickening in the midline of the lobe of the primitive pharynx. So it begins to develop from the endodermal thickening in the midline of floor of primitive pharynx behind the tuberculum impar and during the third week of intrauterine life. This thickening is soon depressed below the surface to form a diverticulum called thyroglossal duct. This duct grows downward across the tongue, then descends in front of the neck. So this is the endodermal thickening from the floor of the primitive pharynx around the third week of intrauterine life, and soon it depressed below the surface to form a diverticulum that is known as thyroglossal duct. Then this duct grows downwards across the tongue and then descends in front of the neck. This is the, it grows descend around and forward in front of the neck. This is the path of development. In the neck, it passes in front of the hyoid bone, binds around its lower border to become retrohyoid. Here, this is higher tone, and here first it goes downward in front of the hyoid, then it goes backward and become retrohyoid, then again it downward, finally descends below the hyoid with slight inclination to one side, usually to left, to reach its definitive position by the end of 7th week. So by the end of 7th week, it thyroid gland develops. Here its tip bifurcate and proliferate to form the bilateral terminal swelling, which expands to form the thyroid gland. Here its tip bifurcate and forms thyroid gland. Then a portion of duct near its tip sometimes forms the pyramidal lobe. So this portion near its tip may form pyramidal lobe, and the remaining duct disappears. The site of origin of thyroglossal duct is, however, marked by forum and cecum. So site of origin is marked by the forum and cecum at the junction of anterior 2/3 and posterior 1/3 of tongue in adult. So forum and cecum is present in the tongue in between the anterior 2/3 and posterior 1/3, junction of anterior 2/3 and posterior 1/3 of tongue. And this remaining duct, thyroglossal duct, is disappear if it persists. So it may in the form of thyroglossal fistula or maybe another anomaly. And the site of origin, as we know, is present in the form of forum and cecum. And the thyroid is the earliest glandular tissue to develop and becomes functional during the 3rd month. And the ultimobranchial bodies from 5th pharyngeal pouches and neural crest cells become incorporated secondary into thyroid gland and forms parafollicular cells or C cells. So C cells or parafollicular cells originated from the neural crest cells and ultimobranchial body from the 5th pharyngeal pouches. Is about the development of or embryology of thyroid gland. Let's talk about the clinical correlations of thyroid gland and applied importance of thyroid gland. As we know, goiter, it is a very famous name, goiter. It is the enlargement of thyroid gland, except during mensuration and lactation. So normally it enlarged during the mensuration and lactation, but goiter is enlargement of thyroid gland other than these two conditions. So it is the enlargement of thyroid gland. Then about the hypothyroidism, again it is very common term, hypothyroidism, and its incidence presently very high and occurs due to insufficient secretion of the T3 and T4 hormone. The decreased level of T3 and T4 causes increased secretion of TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. So hypothyroidism causes cretinism in children and myxedema in adults. These are the clinical conditions known as cretinism in children and myxedema in adults. And in hypothyroidism, T3 and T4 decreased and TSH is increased. Then third one is hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis. Occurs due to excess secretion of T3 and T4 hormone. The thyrotoxicosis clinically presents as tachycardia, tremors, and systolic droop. The main effects are due to increased basic metabolic rate. So hyperthyroidism, also known as thyrotoxicosis, and simple goiter, also known as puberty goiter. It is enlargement of thyroid gland without the signs of hyperthyroidism. So it commonly occurs in females at the age of puberty. Hence, it is also called as puberty goiter. It is enlargement of thyroid gland without the signs of hyperthyroidism. It occurs due to deficiency of iodine in diet, which is essential for synthesis of thyroid. So this enlargement occurs due to deficiency of iodine in our diet. That's why currently we used iodized salt. Then the decreased level of T3 and T4 lead to increased secretion of TSH. TSH is thyroid stimulating hormone. When T3 and T4 decrease, stimulating hormone is increased from the pituitary gland. The TSH causes hyperplasia of the thyroid gland. This TSH causes hyperplasia of thyroid gland. And about the retroesternal goiter, its name indicates retroesternal, means behind the sternum. In this downward expansion behind the sternum is called retroesternal goiter. It can compress trachea, leading to dangerous dyspnea. It means if thyroid gland enlarged and it lies behind the sternum, it compresses the trachea, and when trachea is compressed, the dyspnea is occur, which lead to dangerous situation or dangerous dyspnea. Then effects of the massive enlargement of thyroid gland. Suppose thyroid gland is enlarged backward or downward direction, but it cannot enlarge upward due to attachment of its facial sheath and sternothyroid muscle due to the thyroid cartilage. So the backward enlargement is common because the thyroid capsule is relatively thin posteriorly, and the backward enlargement of the gland buries itself around the sides of the trachea and esophagus. So when the trachea and esophagus is compressed, dyspnea, which is known as difficulty in breathing, it occurs due to pressure on the enlarged gland on trachea. Then dysphagia, it is difficulty in swallowing, is because of pressure on the esophagus. Then dysphonia, it is hoarseness of voice, is due to pressure on the recurrent laryngeal nerve, which lies in the tracheoesophageal groove. See recurrent laryngeal nerve in the anatomy of thyroid gland. It is related with the inferior part of the lower lobe, lateral lobe, and it is accompanied with the inferior thyroid artery and lies in the tracheoesophageal groove. So when this recurrent laryngeal nerve pressurized, dysphonia, hoarseness of voice occur. Then about the thyroidectomy. When surgery of thyroid gland, enlarged thyroid gland is, or any cause because of CA thyroid or maybe due to any cause, ligation of arteries during the thyroidectomy, the superior thyroid artery and external laryngeal nerve, as we know, diverge from each other near the apex, while superior thyroid artery accompany the external laryngeal nerve, and near the apex it diverges from the apex of thyroid gland. So So it ligated near the apex of the lobe during thyroidectomy. Should be superior thyroid artery should be ligated close to the apex of thyroid lobe to avoid injury to the external laryngeal nerve. Vice versa in the in case of inferior thyroid artery. As we know, inferior thyroid artery accompany with the recurrent laryngeal nerve. And recurrent laryngeal nerve lies very close to the inferior thyroid artery near the base of the thyroid lobe. So during thyroidectomy, the inferior thyroid artery should be ligated away from the base of thyroid lobe to avoid injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So superior thyroid artery ligated close to the apex and inferior thyroid artery away from the base of the thyroid lobe because of the relation with the external laryngeal nerve and recurrent laryngeal nerve. Then a few words about the congenital anomalies of thyroid gland. As we discussed the development of thyroid gland, thyroglossal cyst or fistula. If normally, as we know, normally the thyroglossal duct atrophies and disappears, but a part of it may persist and form a cyst called thyroglossal cyst. And the thyroglossal cyst may form anywhere along the course of the thyroglossal duct. If this thyroglossal cyst ruptures, it communicates to the exterior by a secondary opening on the surface of the neck. It is called thyroglossal fistula. Then few words about the anomalous lobes and thyroid hemiagenesis. One of lobe of thyroid gland may be missing. It is known as thyroid hemiagenesis. Then pyramidal lobe, it often arises from upper aspect of isthmus, usually on the left side. It may be too small or too large to reach the hyoid bone. Isthmus may be present. Then anomaly in the position of thyroid gland. As we know the path of development, the thyroid tissue formed anywhere along the course of thyroglossal duct. Lingual thyroid, commonest abnormal site of thyroid tissue formation is the tongue because it arises from the, its path arises from the foramen cecum, from the junction of anterior two-third and posterior one-third of tongue, and may be found just below the mucosa of tongue, at the foramen cecum or within the muscles of the tongue, and may cause difficulty in swallowing due to lingual swelling. If this lingual thyroid is present, it causes difficulty in swallowing. Then sublingual thyroid, it is thyroid tissue presents high in the neck above, at or just below the hyoid bone. Then intrathoracic thyroid. Sometimes the whole gland or part of it may lie in the thorax. So it is known as intrathoracic thyroid. Then ectopic thyroid tissue. A small mass of thyroid tissue may be present at the abnormal sites like the larynx, trachea, esophagus, and pericardium. So these are the abnormal sites of thyroid tissue known as ectopic thyroid tissue. So this is all about the thyroid gland. Now lecture is over. Thank you for hearing me patiently. And over to moderator Dr. Anju Gupta.
Thank you. Students, I thank you must have gained immensely, because Dr. Vandana Sharma has just now concluded her lecture on thyroid gland. And in this lecture, she has covered the thyroid gland in its totality. She spoke about the macroscopic anatomy of thyroid gland, relations of thyroid gland, its blood supply, nerve supply, everything, lymphatic drainage. And she has spoken in just the way in which you are supposed to understand and also answer in your exam. Then she has also told you very clearly and very descriptively about the histology of thyroid gland, in which she has told you about the follicles and parafollicular cells also. So thyroid gland is not only about thyroid hormones, but also about calcitonin, which is responsible for blood calcium level. She has spoken in great length on embryology of thyroid gland. I think you must have understood this, because in embryology, when a fetus is developing, you know a child will develop from a zygote, a single cell, isn't it? So all the organs have to undergo various differentiations. So they have different stages. And finally, we get the fully developed gland or any organ. So you have heard it very nicely, because madam had explained embryology very in great detail. She told you that the pharyngeal arches which are formed, so the junction of first pharyngeal arch and second pharyngeal arch, in the midline from it, there is a thickening of endoderm, which is going to result in formation of thyroid gland. And she also told you about the applied anatomy related to this thyroglossal cyst. If the thyroglossal duct from which the thyroid gland is developing, if it persists, it will result into this. She talked in great length on the clinical aspect of thyroid gland. Hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism, even the treatment of hyperthyroidism. She told you very clearly all the topics which you will be studying in later classes in surgery and medicine. So I think, students, you must have gained immensely from this lecture. And you should apply this in your exams too. See, this is the benefit of webinar. In seminar, only the students of Bhopal could have attended this lecture. But in webinar, all the medical students of all the faculties around the world have attended this lecture and all have gained through it. With this, madam, I would like to thank you from the depth of my heart to come and attend this and give this lecture so as to benefit our students. Thank you, Vandana Sharma ma'am. Thank you, all the colleagues, seniors and juniors, all the doctors around the world, all the students around the world who have attended this webinar. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you. Video off.
Ha, madam, video
off. Okay.
Thank you, everybody. I just request everyone to please type in your questions, or you can mail me the questions at webinar@homeopathy360.com for any queries. I request the audience to please send your questions to the email ID webinar@homeopathy360.com. Mail your queries. I'm just typing the email ID in the chat box. We have our next session at 4 o'clock with RBTS Homeopathic Medical College. So I hope everybody will join us there. You can register for the webinar if you have not done yet. Visit the website for the same. And you can register for the webinar series. That's with the RBTS Homeopathic Medical College. I'll just post the link of the website. Our website. I hope everybody will be joining us. You can mail me your queries at webinar@homeopathy360.com. And you can register for the webinar at 4 o'clock at this link. I have posted the link in the chat box. So thank you, everyone. Thank you, audience, for your patient listening. We come to the end of this session. Thank you, everybody. Tomorrow we have the session at 12 o'clock again, continuing this webinar. Thank you.